It's 9 o'clock.
Athens International Radio on 104.4 FM stereo.
Kalimera, welcome to Good Morning Athens, a one-hour program bringing you all the latest news, information, and plenty of ideas of what to do, where to do it for visitors and residents of the Greek capital. This is the first edition of Good Morning Athens. I'm Lou Economopoulos.
And I'm Alexia Ambrazi. Our sound engineer today is Kosmas Andreopoulos. It's Friday, the 9th of July. It's a new summer day, and we invite you to stay tuned with us on 104.4 FM for domestic news and world news, original features, music, and advice on how to make your time in Athens as good as it gets. This is Athens International Radio 104.4's program, Good Morning Athens, designed especially for you. And now for the headline news.
Forest fires continue to plague Greece, aided by soaring temperatures and brisk winds. Greek authorities issue forest fire warnings for Greater Athens for the next 3 days. Greek hoteliers want drug abuse at rehabilitation centers banned in Athens. State authorities don't agree. Olympic Games bill passes by majority vote in the Greek parliament. Greek Prime Minister meets with Athens Olympics organizing chief to discuss preparation work for the Games. The United States says it's in favor of EU efforts to end economic isolation for occupied northern Cyprus.
Well, surprise, surprise, clear skies and high temperatures are forecast across the country for today. Winds will be light and variable in the Ionian, northerly and stronger 6 to 8 Beaufort in the Aegean, easing off by the afternoon. Temperatures are expected to rise as high as 36 degrees Celsius or 97 Fahrenheit in the north, 38 degrees Celsius or 100 Fahrenheit on the mainland, and 38 degrees Celsius or 95 Fahrenheit on the islands. In Athens, there will be clear skies with northeasterly winds 5 to 7 Beaufort and a high of 36 degrees Celsius or 97 Fahrenheit. In Thessaloniki, it'll be a sunny day with northeasterly winds of 3 to 4 Beaufort and a high of 35 degrees Celsius or 95 Fahrenheit.
At 9:03, let's take a look at traffic conditions around Athens this morning. Petrourali Street is reporting heavy traffic towards the center of Athens. Marathonis Avenue near Yetika also has increased traffic. We also have increased traffic in Mesogeion Avenue and Katehaki Avenue, which is close to Eliupolos. And there's also problems in Vasilis Konstantinou Avenue and Kaliroi Street near Ardidou Street.
Time for the business news now. Good morning to George Petropoulos.
Good morning for me. The Athens Stock Exchange, the general index, ended the session at 2,326.07 points, marked by a loss of 967 points, or of 0.41%, where widespread selling of bank shares outweighed more lively trade in small caps yesterday. Turnover rose to 108.07 million euros. Following the 6 day falling the indices of the major European stock markets, they were all marked by increases yesterday. One important factor which led to the rise was a decision by the Bank of England not to go ahead with a further rise in its interest rates. At the London Stock Exchange, the FTSE 100 rose by 0.52%, closing at 4,381.10 points, while the DAX in Frankfurt was also marked by a slight rise of 0.10%, wrapping up at 3,934.48 points. At the Paris Stock Exchange, the CAC 40 index rose by 0.27%, closing at 3,670.41 points. At the New York Stock Exchange, stocks slipped yesterday as technology shares fell after Yahoo's earnings disappointed some investors and lukewarm sales figure dragged down retailers. At the closing bell, the Dow Jones Industrial Average was down 0.67%, closing at 10,171.56 points. Going to the exchange rates, the dollar slipped against the euro yesterday after the U.S. Department of Homeland Security warned that terrorists may attempt attacks before the November 2nd presidential election. The euro rose to $1.2385, increased by 0.11%. The euro was also increased against all other major currencies as well. It is sold today against 134.72 yens, 1.5175 Swiss francs, and 0.6672 pounds sterling.
Athens International Radio 104.4. You're listening to the news.
Hundreds of firefighters, aided by planes and helicopters, battled a series of wildfires in and around Athens yesterday, some burning for 3 days now. The most serious fire broke out in a forested area about 35 kilometers north of the capital near the seaside town of Kalamos. The blaze forced the evacuation of four summer camps with nearly 1,000 children. Firefighters managed to bring under control the blaze at Anavisos, some 50 kilometers southeast of Athens, and at two other sites outside the city. At this hour, a fire remains out of control at Achladia near the town of Aegio and Peloponnesos. According to the local authorities, an unknown number of homes have been burnt down. 123 firefighters and four planes are at the scene. On Thursday, firefighters had to deal with 180 blazes throughout Greece. Meanwhile, police have arrested a man on charges of arson through negligence in relation to a fire in the area of Afidnes in Attica. The man, an inhabitant of the area, is alleged to have caused the fire while welding a fence in his garden. The welding equipment sparked the flames that devoured 15,000 square meters of almond and pistachio trees and vineyards.
With soaring temperatures and gale force winds expected, the Greek government's civil defense agency issued fire warnings for Greater Athens for the next 3 days, keeping authorities on alert. Warnings were issued for Athens and central Greece, described as being at a very high level of danger. This was based on temperatures that are forecast to approach 40 degrees Celsius or 100 Fahrenheit. Meanwhile, Deputy Labor Minister Gerasimos Yakoumatos made an appeal to employers to take all necessary precautions to make sure that workers are protected from high temperatures for the next few days.
The Union of Attica Hoteliers official proposal to ban drug abuse rehabilitation and support centers from the Greek capital during the Olympic Games has met with strict condemnation from state authorities. The proposal was made by hoteliers as a measure of preventing drugs-related crime, as well as for the supposed improvement of the city's image. Nikitas Kaklamanis, the Minister of Health, has blasted away the suggestions put forward in the memo. He criticized the hoteliers of planning without taking into account those responsible for such decisions. He recently said in a Greek parliament,
Εμείς αρνούμεθα, και το έχω πει δημόσια, και σας το λέω και σας απόλυτα υπεύθυνα,
I have already stated this publicly, but now I will tell you we refuse to take on the role of dog catchers as with a human soul. Full stop, said the health minister. Mayor of Athens, Dora Bakayanis, also reacted to the hotelier's memo with great disdain, saying Athens does not need to wear an Olympic mask.
Η Αθήνα δεν έχει σκοπό να φορέσει κανένα Ολυμπιακό προσωπείο.
Athens has no intention of wearing an Olympic mask, the mayor said. Athens is proud as a city and for what it is. Our aim is to focus on the essential means of combating the drug problem. Christos Yannakis, director of the Greek Organization for Combating Drugs, also known as OKANA, reacted to the proposal for the hoteliers by calling it inhumane.
Θα έπρεπε να δείξουμε κατανόηση και όχι να εκτιθέμεθα με δηλώσεις.
We should show understanding and not expose ourselves in ways that present us an inhumane country and peoples, said the OKANA director.
A bill on issues related to the Olympic and Paralympic Games was passed by a majority vote in Greek Parliament last night. Also approved in the Culture Ministry's bill were 8 amendments. One of the amendments gives the government permission to request the assistance of international organizations or other countries in handling damages or losses during the Games resulting from natural, technological and other disasters. Alternate Culture Minister Fani Pali Petralia says the amendment does not deal with military or police forces, but rather human and material resources of civil protection. The main opposition, Socialist PASOK party, criticized the amendment, saying it shifts costs to the Greek state, creating a negative psychological climb and, through extensive publicity, damages game security. The Greek Communist Party and the Coalition of the Left Movements and Ecology Party called the amendment unconstitutional and that it cedes the country's sovereign rights.
Prime Minister Kostas Karamanlis had a meeting yesterday with Athens Olympics Organizing Committee President Yan Angelopoulos Daskalaki, where they once again explored the progress in planning for the Olympics, which begin in just over a month. Angelopoulos Daskalaki said at the end of this month, the Olympic Village opens, therefore there are a lot of issues to discuss with the Prime Minister.
Η επιτυχία της Ελλάδος τον Αύγουστο πρέπει να είναι μια επιτυχία η οποία δεν θα μπορεί να έχει από πίσω της ερωτηματικά.
Angelopoulos Daskalaki said Greece's success in August must be a clear success, leaving no room for doubts. Meanwhile, International Olympic Committee Coordination Chairman Dennis Oswald ended his two-day inspection tour of Olympic sites and said he was impressed with the progress being made so far. Oswald said he was astonished with the roof of the Olympic Stadium, where he admitted that he had his doubts as to whether it would be slipped into place. He said Spanish architect Santiago Calatrava's accomplishment is now in place and looking very good. Oswald also said that 80% of the tickets for the Games have been sold and that this was satisfactory.
Osama bin Laden, believed to be hiding along the Afghanistan-Pakistan border, is directing an al-Qaeda effort to launch an attack on the United States sometime this year, the New York Times reported today, citing anonymous U.S. officials. On Thursday, Homeland Security Secretary Tom Ridge warned Americans that al-Qaeda might try to carry out a large-scale attack to disrupt the November elections, but he offered no details. Ridge said that the warning was based on intelligence received from credible sources gathered over the past months.
The International Court of Hague is expected to reach a decision today concerning the matter of legality of Israel's West Bank barrier. The so-called security wall has caused strong reactions across the world and has fired up violence in the Middle East. Tel Aviv has already made clear that it will not accept what is expected to be among the most watched rulings in the 58 years of the International Court. Israel has already completed 200 kilometers of a barrier that should eventually stretch for 730 kilometers. The barrier has cut off thousands of Palestinians from farms, schools, relatives and jobs, but Israelis credit it with stopping suicide bombings and shopping and shooting attacks that have killed hundreds of Israelis during nearly 4 years since the beginning of Intifada.
The United States has welcomed the European Commission's supporting measures for the Turkish-occupied north of Cyprus. State Department spokesman Richard Boucher said yesterday that the moves made could help towards the final reunification of the island. Boucher added that the administration is examining a number of programs in coordination with the EU. Cyprus has been divided since the Turkish invasion in 1974.
And the European Commission issued an official warning to seven member states, including Greece, on the non-implementation of the directive regarding the handling of urban waste. The Commission sent letters of official warning to Greece, France, Ireland, Spain, Italy, Great Britain, and Portugal. The letter said they have not installed units for the processing of urban waste in many cities and towns with population of more than 15,000 inhabitants, ignoring the deadline, which had ended on December 2000.
The Greek National Council on Foreign Policy will be meeting for the first time on July 16th to discuss the future of Europe after the enlargement. Also on the agenda for the Council will be the course of Greek-Turkish relations and developments in the Cyprus issue. Heading the Council is Foreign Minister Petros Moliviatis. Representatives of all parliamentary parties except the Communist Party participate in the Council.
And traffic on the section of Vari Skoropio Avenue between Kalymnou Avenue and Vari Church will be disrupted until tomorrow due to roadworks. Traffic will also be disrupted on the coastal Karamanli Alkyonidon Avenue in the suburb of Voula until July 12th. Roadworks on Athina Street in the city center will cause traffic disruptions between Omonia and Hermou Street from 10 p.m. until 6 a.m. daily until July 14th. And nighttime works on Vasilios Konstantinou, Arditu and Kalirois Avenues are also expected to cause traffic problems until July 14th.
As we expect a heat wave this weekend, we find it useful to inform our listeners about the precautions they should take. More than 35,000 people died during last August heat waves throughout Europe. Our reporter, Vanna Koutroulou, talks to physician and advisor to the Center of Accident Prevention, Themis Spiridopoulos. His first answer deals with what exactly is a heat wave.
There's no unanimous definition of heat waves. It depends on each country's climate. For example, in Greece, a heat wave is a period of three consecutive days during which the air temperature is over 37 degrees Celsius and the mean daily temperature is at least 31 degrees.
Now, could you tell us who is particularly at risk during the period of a heat wave?
There are certain population groups that are at higher risk when we are dealing with heat waves. First of all, elderly and people with chronic diseases. These groups are vulnerable because their physiological responses are limited. Other vulnerable population group is infants and very young children because their capacity to protect themselves is limited. And last, people working outdoors in hot environments are also a vulnerable target group due to their physical exertion.
How would one recognize a heat disorder?
In order to make this clear to the audience, I will give you some steps of symptoms. At first, we may have symptoms of dehydration. We may feel like losing our energy and performance. We may feel tired. We may have cramps. If our body temperature becomes over 39 degrees Celsius, we may feel dizzy, weak, or extremely tired. But in this situation, when our body temperature is over 39 degrees Celsius, we say that we have a heat exhaustion. If in this situation our mental functions are not affected, if our body temperature comes over 41 degrees of Celsius, then we say we have a heat stroke. Man's mental functions are affected, and he may lose his consciousness and become in coma. Only 20% of patients with heat strokes have prodromal symptoms. So it is necessary to prevent this situation, not to recognize it and starting dealing with it.
Well, could you give us some safety tips in order to prevent a heat disorder?
Well, there are some simple and general tips that one may follow in order to avoid being affected by a heat wave. First one is to stay in an air-conditioned environment. You should try to drink more than usual. Drink water before you feel thirsty and avoid alcohol. Attention should be taken with commercially prepared drinks, which often contain much sugar, and therefore you may lose more water by urine. When the air temperatures are extremely high, we should wear light, loose-fitting and lightly colored clothes. If we stay at home, we should take as many as possible cool showers or baths. And we must reduce our physical activity to the minimum standard. And if we have programmed some outdoor activities, we should postpone them. Concerning children, parents should not leave their children unattended, for example, in a car or even in the home. They should always keep an eye on them and take care of their drinking needs.
That was physician Themis Spiridopoulos in an interview with Vanna Koutroulou.
And 5 weeks before the Olympics opening ceremony and more than a month after smashing through its delivery deadline, a major U.S. defense contractor is having to scrap arrangements for an extensive security system during the Olympics. Instead, as Athens News newspaper reports today, it is working with the Greek government on a curtailed version of the original system. Themis Tsiliopoulos has more on that story.
Science Applications International Corporation, also known as SAIC, a major U.S. defense contractor, and the Greek government have reached an impasse after SAIC was unable to fulfill its contractual obligation to provide a turnkey solution for Olympic security. As reported in today's Athens News, the 255 million euro deal included constructing more than 100 command centers linked by an integrated software system. While the command centers have largely been completed, it is the software that has crucially failed to work. Under a revised deal that was struck on July 6th between the Greek authorities and SAIC's project manager, David Tubbs, Greece is to pay over $30 million for provisional use of the centers and the system. Highly placed SAIC executives arrived in Athens on July 7th to meet with public order ministry officials to make firm the new deal. Although the Ministry of Public Order is in charge of Olympic security, it is the defense ministry that is responsible for the contract and disbursements. For the money to be paid out, it would have to be done in the manner specified by the contract, and I am categorical on that point, said a senior Greek defense official. SAIC was to have provided the system, known as C4I, on May 28, the day its contract expired. The contract was silently extended so that SAIC could complete its part of the deal. Final acceptance was to take place by July 10th. Hefty daily fines against SAIC for running over contract were waived. But the truce ended on the morning of July 1st during a scheduled demonstration of the system. On that day, police demanded the delivery of their system. About 100 police showed up in uniform that day and demanded their passwords and logins so they could use the system. The fire brigade and Coast Guard also demanded use of their command centers on the same day. Psyche responded by shutting down the system. As it stands, the Greek police do not believe the system works even as a system. Sources close to the technical committee, which monitors implementation of the contract, say, quote, "The entire committee, without exception, believe that the state-of-the-art heart of the security system, known as Command Decision Support System, is crap, does not work, is unreliable, not suitable for operational use, and in addition, it does not meet the specifications," unquote. Police sources say security for the games will be unaffected because police have been drilling on the worst-case scenario basis that the system will not be available. Operational parts of the system may be usable as standalones rather than as part of the envisaged integrated system. Quote, "Strictly in terms of meeting the security needs of the games, the individual pieces of the system operating as standalone applications are quite sufficient. It may require some additional manpower, but that's really the only impact," police sources say. However, if the revised deal actually goes through, many are bound to ask why $250,000 was paid for something that does not work as contracted.
Themis Chiliopoulos with that report.
For many decades, relations between Greece and its Turkish neighbor have been strained and limited to a thin thread of formal contacts between the two countries. An incident on the islet of Imia Kardak nearly brought the two countries to war. However, in 1999, after earthquakes in both Turkey and Greece, the so-called historical enemies became involved in an unexpected process of improving relations. This was not always formal. For instance, take the invitation that Turkish Prime Minister made to the Greek Prime Minister Kostas Karamanlis. It was not an invitation to a summit, but to the wedding of his daughter. Alex Voudouris reports.
The Greek-Turkish reapproachment has been a product of what is usually called civic diplomacy or seismic diplomacy initiated by the earthquakes in the two countries. In August 1999, a devastating earthquake hit Marmara region in Turkey and claimed the life of thousands of people. Greece was among the first countries to send rescue teams. 1 month later, Athens was hit by a strong earthquake and Turkey had instantly sent rescue teams to Greece. Since then, the people of the two neighboring countries showed their preference for friendship and peace, and thus their leaders followed as a consequence the public's wish in their diplomatic initiatives. That was perhaps the end of the Cold War era between the two countries. The earthquakes played a significant role in the reevaluation and redefinition of political and strategic interests, but we should note that such a process has been initiated 2 months before the fatal incidents by the then two foreign ministers, Ismail Cem and George Papandreou. 3 months ago, a new government was elected in Greece. Just before the elections, the then main opposition New Democracy leader and current Prime Minister Kostas Karamanlis paid a visit to Turkey and met with the Turkish Prime Minister Recep Tayyip Erdogan. Obviously, Karamanlis' intention was to prove to both Turkish administration and to the Greek people that if he became a prime minister, the preservation of the good relations with the neighboring country would have been his first priority. As soon as he became the new prime minister of Greece, he had to handle the critical issue of Cyprus with regard to a united entry of the country in the European Union, bearing in mind he should avoid harming the bilateral relations with Turkey in any way. Few days after the referendum in Cyprus, which resulted in the semi-entrance of the island in the European Union, the Turkish prime minister paid a visit to Athens and held talks with Kostas Karamanlis. Both leaders have then ascertained with satisfaction the preservation and the progress made in the Greek-Turkish relations. In fact, not only the two leaders have managed to take further steps forward in improving bilateral relations, but also the people of the two countries have shown the same enthusiasm. The Eurovision contest that took place in Istanbul this year proved that both Turks and Greeks will do anything possible to prevail the amicable atmosphere. Even the Euro 2004 and the unexpected Greek victory produce a fine example of friendship between the two nations. In fact, the flags of both countries were waving when Haristeas scored what proved to be the winning goal against Portugal. After the final whistle, Greek and Turkish fans joined in one another's national dances, the Halle and the Sirtaki. On Sunday, the Greek Prime Minister will attend the wedding of his Turkish counterpart's daughter, Esra, as one of the three wedding witnesses. Such a move is described by international relations analysts as a new form of diplomacy called marriage diplomacy that follows up the seismic diplomacy that former Greek and Turkish governments have implemented. However, we shouldn't forget that territorial differences still exist, and the implementation of the marriage diplomacy is yet not enough for both countries to overcome the issue of the continental shelf in the Aegean Sea.
That was Alexandra Vuduri on the Greek-Turkish diplomacy of marriage.
Aşk kaç büyüğünden Aşk dön ölümden Aşk bir sebepten Gel gir dünyama
Listening to a song about light called Phos in Greek and Ash in Turkish, a Greek-Turkish musical union by singers Mando of Greece and Sardab of Turkey. Look at what the Greek press is saying today. It's a Greek press review compiled by Alexandra Vuduri. Lou?
The top stories in most Greek newspapers today are the new legislation presented by the Greek government aimed at settling hundreds of outstanding tax cases, and also the 180 wildfires that occurred yesterday in several parts of Greece. Kathimerini leads on a new legislation concerning the settlement of hundreds of outstanding tax cases. The newspaper describes the regulation as a brave settlement by the government, which will cover the needs of the national budget. Nea, however, sees the settlement as a burden for almost 800,000 businesses and self-employed professionals. The newspaper also says the New Democracy Party, before being elected as government, was highly critical of such measures, whilst today it is blackmailing low-income professionals by making them choose between tax control and more taxes. Eleftherotypia agrees with that and adds that the settlement is chiefly beneficial only for big companies, but it is not especially advantageous to self-employed professionals with small incomes. The newspaper also reports that the main opposition party has made a boisterous criticism towards the new legislation. Ethnos also sees the new legislation as a burden for low-income professionals. And Vima describes the settlement as salty and provides its readers with a detailed account of the new tax legislation. Alexia?
The story on the 180 wildfires that have occurred nationwide is another top story on the Greek press. Eleftherotypia reports that residents on the southeastern outskirts of Athens spent dramatic hours last night in anxious anticipation about their homes and belongings due to a major blaze that started in the evening. The newspaper also reports that in the Aegio region in the Peloponnese, numerous homes have been destroyed by a major fire. Eleftherotypia says that the high winds have made the fire brigade's efforts an enormous challenge. Vima also says that the summer season has begun on a sour note due to the many fires. The newspaper reports that the state mechanism has proven inept in dealing with the situation, particularly this summer, with only 1 month ahead of the Olympic Games. Nea describes yesterday's situation as a nightmare, since firefighters had to deal with 183 fires throughout the country. Eleftheros Tipos says that the country was a hostage of the fires yesterday. The paper believes that most fires occurred because there hasn't been any form of cleanup in the forested areas. Some newspapers also lead on a Eurobarometer survey of Greece presented yesterday in Athens by the European Commission. Kathimerini reports that according to the survey, Greeks are the most optimistic among their EU counterparts about the economic situation, only a few months after their general elections. Meanwhile, 51% of Greeks are optimistic about their personal lives, whilst the average figure for other EU members is almost 39%. Vima also leads on the results of the European survey, saying that one in two Greeks has an optimistic outlook of the future, also believing that during the next 5 years, their quality of life will improve considerably.
You're tuned in to Athens International Radio, 104.4 FM.
It's 9:32 and time for some news headlines. Forest fires continue to plague Greece, aided by soaring temperatures and brisk winds. Greek authorities issue forest fire warnings for Greater Athens for the next 3 days. Greek hoteliers want drug abuse rehabilitation centers banned in Athens. State authorities don't agree. Olympic Games bill passes by majority vote in the Greek parliament. Greek Prime Minister meets with Athens Olympics organizing chief to discuss preparation work for the Games. The United States says it's in favor of EU efforts to end economic isolation for occupied northern Cyprus.
And now for a quick look at the weather. Clear skies and high temperatures are forecast across the country for today. Winds will be light and variable in the Ionian, northerly and stronger, 6 to 8 Beaufort in the Aegean, easing off by the afternoon. In Athens, there will be clear skies with northeasterly winds, 5 to 7 Beaufort, and a high of 36 degrees Celsius or 97 Fahrenheit.
And there's heavy traffic reported now in the center of Athens. The Kifisias Avenue towards the center of Athens is heavy and jammed. Mesogeion Avenue also near Katakaki Avenue and Alexandros Avenue and Panormou Junction also have their problems. Vasilis Sofias Avenue has problems to the center of Athens. Tsingrou Avenue to the coastal Posidonis Avenue and Kaliroi Street near Adritu Street also has problems at this hour. Heavy traffic is also reported at Marathonos Avenue near Yerika Junction and in both directions of Patisian Street in downtown Athens.
The opening ceremony of the Athens Olympic Games is now just 35 days away. George Petropoulos, our Olympics expert, is here with an update on the preparations before the final countdown. George?
The first day of the Flames' two-day stopover in Cyprus, the last stop of the International Torch Relay, came to a close with a major concert by Marios Tokas yesterday. The cities of Cyprus also happened to be the first stop in the heart of Hellenic culture, shortly before the Flame is set to enter Greece. The President of the Republic of Cyprus, Tasos Papadopoulos, raised the torch outside the presidential palace in Lefkosia. The Greek delegation reached Paphos yesterday morning, en route from Sofia, and the flame was received with the honors reserved for a visiting head of state. The President of the Cyprus Olympic Committee and IOC member Kikis Lazaridis accepted the flame while the Olympic anthem was being played and in turn handed it to the crew of an old sailing ship that transported it to the medieval castle of Paphos. The Cyprus torch relay ends today with a Paralimni Larnaca leg. Veteran champion hurler Stavros Georgis will be the last torchbearer. Athens 2004 President Yanis Angelopoulos Askalaki will attend today's events and will then board the aircraft Zeus for the very last air transit of the International Torch Relay with Heraklio as his final destination. The Olympic flame returns to Greece today, having visited all of the five continents in 26 hunters in 34 cities, and will carry on its trip visiting the whole of the country. It is today at 6 p.m. that it will be arriving at the Nikos Kazantzakis Airport of Heraklio in Crete. The course will continue tomorrow by visiting the ancient Knossos, where one of the torchbearers will be the Athens 2004 Organizing Committee President, Yanis Angelopoulos. The torchbearers will visit the whole of the Cretan island, from where it will travel to the islands of the Aegean on Tuesday.
Amid all the skepticism of money and drugs, the Olympic Games still produces some of the greatest stories of human achievement to found in the annals of sport. Occasionally, it is a rags-to-riches success or an against-all-odds adversity, a victory of the kind to be found in the film world. Sometimes it is someone turning back the years to show that they can still do it. Barney Spender has more on this.
Is this the year when the Olympic Games gets taken over by the crumblies? The oldies who say no to the advancing years and crave one last crack at the glories of the Olympic Games? Maybe not. Not quite. But the possible presence of at least three high-profile 40-somethings, Sofia Sakharova, Martina Navratilova and Mike Powell, suggests the age barriers are beginning to tumble. At 40, the former world long jump champion Powell is the baby of the trio. He retired from the sport 3 years ago, but couldn't resist one last jump at this weekend's US trials. He never won an Olympic gold, having to settle for silver in 1988 and 1992 behind his old rival Carl Lewis. But a giant leap of 8.95 metres during the 1991 World Championships means he still holds the world record. Navratilova, now 47, is already assured of making her Olympic debut in Athens after being named in the US tennis team. Navratilova, of course, has never really retired. Even when she gave up playing singles after a career that brought her 18 Grand Slam titles, she continued to play doubles with some success, notably a Wimbledon mixed doubles title. As for Sofia Sakharova, who's also 47, the prize is simply being able to compete in Athens at all. As a Greek Olympian in Moscow in 1980 and a former world record holder, Sakharova has picked up the javelin again for the first time in 17 years in a bid to qualify for the embryonic Palestinian team. Her first competition was in Chania, Crete a fortnight ago, when her best throw of 47.23 metres, a Palestinian record, fell short of the qualifying standard, but she remains confident of making the team. If these three are beginning to creak, they should remember British horse rider Lorna Johnston, who was 70 years and 5 days old when she rode at the 1972 Games in Munich. In the meantime, anyone who loves the romance of sport will be praying that Powell and Sakharova make the cut and join Navratilova in Athens, especially if they themselves will never see 40 again.
And that was Barney Spender with that very interesting report on the Olympics. And now the latest sports news from George Petropoulos.
The discussions carry on, and it seems they will continue for a while with regard to the future of Greece's coach, Otto Rehhagel. Both the Greek national team and the German national team want the successful coach to lead them into the World Cup, which will take place in Germany in 2006. The coach himself, in an interview he gave to the German newspaper The Bild, said that two-thirds of his heart belong to Germany and the other third to Greece, but that he will take some time before he decides which side he will be joining for the World Cup. The president of the Greek Football Federation, Vasilis Gagatsis, stated that although Otto Rehagel has signed a contract with the team which expires in 2006, it is up to him to decide as to the team he will continue with before he retires. It all remains to be seen in the next couple of days. Otto Rehagel will be meeting with the German Football Federation in the next 48 hours in order to discuss the possibility of cooperating with the German national team. The Greek national team's success in the year 2004 has led officials and fans that the quality of Greek football, especially in the yearly championship. Guided by these hopes, the owners of the three biggest football clubs in Greece, Panathinaikos, Olympiakos and PAOK of Thessaloniki, which will all be taking part in this season's Champions League, met in a hotel yesterday in order to discuss ways to render Greek football better. The meeting came as a surprise since the three powerful men met having taken the initiative on their own. Their meeting lasted around 2 hours and some of the matters they discussed was the Greek national team's success at the Euro 2004 and the president of the Greek Football Federation and more. European champion and captain of the Athens team Panathinaikos, Angelos Basinas, who were reigning champions of the Greek Championship last season, has been given the green light by his team to sign with the European team if he wishes to do so. The midfielder, who wishes to play in the English Premier League, prefers to sign with Liverpool.
A number of cultural events are planned for today in the Athens area. Here now is Nikki Liberaki to fill us in on what's on.
The first tribute to the Japanese cinema was a great success, and now the Panhellenic Association of Film Critics have prepared another event titled European Cinematographers, which promises to excite the audience. In the context of the tribute which starts today, the Athenian audience gets the chance to watch a selection of gems of European cinematography directed by famous filmmakers such as Luis Buñuel, Renoir, Roberto Rossellini, Fassbinder, Andrei Tarkovsky and Bergman. The event is hosted in Athens Trianon Film Center on Patisiou Avenue. Tonight at the House of Art, you can feast your eyes and ears on the hot band from New York City, Star Star, featuring Rock FM's number one DJ, Johnny Holiday. The band's No Balance and Fingers Crossed will open the show. Doors open at 9:30, and the House of Art is located at Sakhturi and Sari Streets in Psiri. Also tonight, France's number one DJ producer Bob Sinclair will treat everyone to his brand of funky house mixology at the Venue Club. The show starts at 11:30. Tonight and for two nights only, you can chill with a Camerata Orchestra performing the sounds of Mozart and Handel at the Lito Epidavros Theatre. An evening of rock, glam, punk, gothic, dark new wave, electro synth pop, industrial, heavy metal, and hard rock nightlife at the Star Star After Show Party. The Data Club at Oyigou 11 in Psiri, Athens. Plus, Dark Zone Productions presents a retrospective dedicated to The Cure and Christian Death and The Cramps live on the big screen.
Euripides' famous tragedy Hippolytus, whose plot also occurs in the tragedy Phaedra, is presented tonight and tomorrow night at 9 p.m. by the Greek National Theatre at Epidavros Ancient Theatre. On this prominent tragedy, we hear Georgia Voglieri.
Special among all the works of ancient drama, Euripides Hippolytus focuses on the love triangle between Hippolytus, Phaedra, and Theseus. Its main theme is enforcement and revenge. Hippolytus was first presented in 428 BC, and only this tragedy has as focal point love, presented as a motive power that leads to the final conflict between body and mind. The interference of gods affects the plot all the way to the end, but the hero's free will is always the main factor, even though it doesn't always lead them to the right choices. For Euripides, clarity and rationality don't secure right actions. His heroes' lives are determined by the struggle between their own will and the god's will. That's a running motive in his plays. In Hippolytus, the reversal arguably does not coincide with a change of fortune. In addition, in this tragedy, reversal and recognition are separated. In contrast to Sophocles' Oedipus, in which all the Aristotelian elements, reversal, recognition, change of fortune, come together, in Hippolytus, Euripides spreads those elements out. Hippolytus has also influenced two other great authors, Seneca and Racine, who both wrote two plays entitled Phaedra.
That was Georgia Vulieri about Epidavros' tragedy Hippolytus, which will be performed at Epidavros' Ancient Theatre tonight and tomorrow.
Well, the biggest festival of American country music will be held tomorrow beginning at 7 p.m. at the Melina Mercury Vrachos Open Air Theater in the Athens suburb of Vironas. The event is being organized by popular Athens radio disc jockey Nikos Karavellas, who is with us today in the studios. And we'll hear more about this. But first, Nico, can you introduce the song that we're going to hear?
Yes, I think it's by Keith Urban, number two, that I have told, okay? Yes, it's one of the greatest songs. It is number one last week in the country charts Billboard.
So now we're going to hear the number one song in the country charts.
Pockets. I got a hole in my jeans. I had a job and lost it, but it won't get to me. 'Cause I'm riding with my baby, and it's a brand new day. We're on the wheels of an angel flying away. And the sun is shining, and this road keeps winding through the prettiest country from Georgia to Tennessee. And I got the one I love beside me, my troubles behind me. I'm alive and I'm free. Who wouldn't want to be me?
So tell us, Mr. Garavella, about the Country Music Association in Greece. It's something that most people would not imagine could exist.
Yes, we have thousands of members, and it is the first time such a club happens in Greece.
And what does it involve exactly? I mean, is it just for country music lovers who
yes, of
get
course.
Together?
We have a paper. It's called The Big Revival, with all the country news. The news that happened here in Athens or all over Greece and Europe and US and everywhere. We have magazines, Country Music Club News. I think the best thing is that this club is a fact.
So where can someone get hold of the newspaper and magazines?
The magazines and the newspapers is free for all the members. And the views for the member is 50 euros per year.
Do you have a number that people can call to find out more about it?
Yes, it's 752-2100.
With 210 before that, of course.
Okay.
And so this is a club.
You like the song?
Yes, yes, it's great. It's brightened our day.
It's number one, so it has to be liked, I'm sure.
Yeah.
Nikos, can you tell us a little about the second Country Music Festival, which is being planned tomorrow night at the Melina Mercuri Outdoor Theater in Vyrnos? I know a lot of people may not know how to get there. The best way, of course, is taking the number 214,
yes,
the 214 bus, I believe, from Academia Street, and also the trolley, number 11.
Yes.
The final stop takes you right to the,
yes, the final
outside
stop
to the theater. Yeah. Tell us a little bit about, of course, this is the second. Can you tell us first about the first? When was the first?
The first was happened in Karpenisi Place, mm-hmm, at the center of Greece. It was a great experience for all the people that went there. It was a big area with horses, with a lot of music,
really,
with
really
drinking,
country.
Really country. Now it happens at the
Melina
Mercuri, and I think it's a very honor, it's a very big honor for me and all the listeners that they will come to the theater and listen to country music. But the most important thing is that the second Country Music Festival has now an international dimension, let's say, because the participants are two groups from Greece and two groups from the U.S.
So can you tell us about these groups a little bit, about what,
yes,
what the people will be hearing,
yes,
tomorrow night at Vyrnos?
Yes, first we have an Indian flute keeper, flute musician, mm-hmm, Tom Baton Kay from Kiowa Nation. He will do the prayer for the beginning.
Ah, that's nice.
After we have George Gakis, well known in North Greece, rockabilly rock and roll, with Julie Massino and Troublemakers. We have Michael Dodson straight from Chicago with country blues. We have Country Gentleman and Andreas Gomosias will do music for from Hank Williams, Waylon Jennings, Willie Nelson, all the great names in country music. And at the midnight, I will be on decks on theater, and I will play country music as always.
As you do on Love Radio.
So you're a DJ for Love Radio.
Yes.
And what time can people tune in to listen to you?
From 10 to 1. At night.
And do you play country music,
country music
only?
Yes. And I think a lot of people know that you know Elvis Presley.
Of course.
Yeah.
But yes, it was a great country singer, first of all. And all the Greeks have at least one record in their homes.
Okay, Elvis Presley.
Every Greek grew up with the songs of Elvis Presley.
We're caught in a trap. I can't walk out because I love you too much, baby. Why can't you see what you're doing to me? When you don't believe a word I say, we can't go on together with suspicious minds, and we can build our dreams on suspicious minds. So with a friend
And of course that's Elvis Presley.
With Suspicious Minds.
Exactly. Just want to remind their listeners again that the second Country Music Festival will be held in Vironas, the Athens suburb of Vironas, tomorrow night. The doors open at 5 p.m., which is quite early for concerts. And the concerts, of course, will start at 7 p.m. Tickets are priced at €20 for adults, and children under 12 have a free entrance. And, of course, this is all under the patronage of the Ministry of Culture. Right, Nicholas?
Yes, yes, yes. That it's a great honor for me and the Country Music Association and all the country listeners all over Greece.
One personal question I'd like to ask. How did you get involved with country music?
Accidentally.
Accidentally?
Yes, it was the American base here in Athens. I listened to the radio and the first song was by Kenny Rogers, The Gambler. Okay. And I was shocked when I listened to his voice. You know, a special voice Kenny Rogers has. Mm. And after that, I will I answer about the kind of music that was playing there, and they told me that it was country music, and I was impressed by that.
And you started your radio career, I believe, with our sister station here in 984, Athens,
yes,
984.
In 1985.
I just want to ask a little bit more about this club in Pankrati. Is it the kind of place where people can really enjoy a song and dance, country music?
Yes, at Tonokio Place, a cafe place. In Pankrati Place.
And do people do line dancing and stuff like
yes,
that?
Yes, of course. Line wow. dancing is the favorite dance.
Yeehaw, ride 'em, cowboy. Well, thank you very much for joining us
Nikos
today.
Nikos Karavelas joining us today on our program.
Thank you.
So we'll all be there at the festival, the Country Music Festival,
thank
for
you,
tomorrow Ersin. Night.
At the nowhere fast, I take one step forward and up two steps back. Couldn't walk a straight line, even if I wanted to.
At 9:58, coming to the end of the Good Morning Athens program. Again, we'd like to thank Nikos Karavelas for stopping by today. We have traffic problems again. Increased traffic in Kifisias Avenue towards Athens, Mesogeion Avenue to the center of Athens, as well as Alexandras Avenue. Vasilis Sofias to Syntagma Square and Vasilis Konstantinou Avenue also reporting heavy traffic at this moment. Achilleo Street, Coastal Avenue and Piraeo Street, close to Karaiskaki Stadium, and towards Piraeus near Moscato are also having problems with traffic. And finally, Petrorali Street to the center of Athens, again, having its traffic problems.
Thank you very much for joining us on Good Morning Athens on Athens International Radio 104.4. It's Alexian Ambrasi and Louis Konomopoulos with the news, headlines, features, and a lot more. Please beware, as authorities have spoken today again about fire warnings, not to endanger Greece any more than it already is in danger.